Payback by Kimberley Chambers. Narrated by Annie Aldington. Prologue. Whistling zippity-doo-dah, Trevor Thomas felt as happy as a pig in shit as he walked the mile-long journey from the pub to his mother's house. As a lad, Trevor had never truly appreciated the sights, smells, atmosphere or community spirit of the East End of London. But after years of living in Yorkshire, he sure did now. Had it not been for his good fortune on the football pools, Trevor would probably still be stuck in a loveless marriage in Leeds. £24,000 was a hell of a lot of money, and there was no way that miserable, greedy, nasty bitch he'd got saddled with was going to get her mucky paws on his windfall. Leaving his four kids behind was a small price to pay if it meant him keeping all the money to himself. Only his mum knew about it. She'd hidden it under her floorboards to keep it away from prying eyes. What Trevor didn't realise as he stopped to chat to an old pal before continuing his journey was that his run of good luck was about to come to a very abrupt and gory end. Vinny and Michael Butler were sitting in a white Ford Transit van. Michael was in the back, Vinny in the passenger seat, as though he were waiting for the driver of the vehicle to return. Both were wearing dark hooded tracksuits to hide their identities, and seeing as they only ever wore the finest designer suits and drove top-of-the-range cars, Vinny doubted even their own mother would recognise them.
"This could be him now, bruv."
"No.
Hold your horses, it isn't." "I hope he fucking hurries up, Vin, because our alibi will be blown sky high if he doesn't." "Stop panicking. We got stacks of time. Like I told you, you've no need to get your hands dirty at all, Michael." "Hold up. Speak of the devil and it appears."
Still whistling the song he couldn't get out of his head, Trevor spotted the two tall men in hooded tracksuits leap out of the van. Apart from wondering if they were boxers who'd been training at the gym, he thought little of it, until they grabbed him from behind. Before Trevor could shout for help, tape was placed over his mouth and he was chucked into the back of the van like a roll of old carpet. As one man expertly tied him up, the other leapt into the front and drove the van away. Eyes wide with a mixture of fear and shock, Trevor now wished he'd listened to his mother's words of wisdom. "As much as I love and miss you, it's not safe for you to be living back in the East End, son. That Vinny Butler's a real force to be reckoned with now, and he won't have forgotten what you did to him. He isn't the type of man to let bygones be bygones." As the van trundled along, Trevor shuddered as his abductor took his hood down. Vinny had been 15, Trevor 19, when he had eloped to Leeds with Yvonne. But even at such a young age, Vinny had already carved out a fearsome reputation back then. That was why Yvonne had insisted they left the area. Trevor wished he'd never clapped eyes on Yvonne Summers.
"Not the greatest choice of song for you to be whistling, was it, Trevor? Because my, oh my, your day is going to be anything but fucking wonderful," Vinny chuckled as he ripped the tape from his victim's mouth.
It was quite dark inside the back of the van, and it wasn't until Vinny switched on a big static torch like the ones workmen used that Trevor could properly see the man whose girlfriend he'd stolen all those years ago. With his mop of thick black hair that he wore brill cream back, and his menacing eyes that were a piercing shade of bright green, Vinny looked even scarier in the light than the dark.
"What you gonna do to me? Please, don't hurt me, Vinny, I beg you. I know what I did was wrong, and I'm very sorry, but I swear if you let me out this van, I'll do anything you say. I'll even move away again if that's what you want. On me mother's life, I will."
Vinny couldn't help but grin. He had waited years for this moment and intended to enjoy every second of it. Trevor had lost all of his hair, had yellow teeth, and reminded Vinny of a fly that was stuck to one of those sticky tape traps that his mum had in her conservatory that was desperately trying to untangle itself.
"If I was a forgiving man, I'd let you jump out this van right now. Unfortunately for you, Trevor, I'm not. Please, Vinny, I'm begging you not to hurt me. It'll be the end of me mum if you do. She has a lot of respect for your mum and aunt, you know. She was gutted over Roy and Lenny's deaths. She's ordered some lovely flowers for their funerals. And I remember your dad well. I used to buy me cigarettes and booze off him once upon a time, Trevor gabbled. So, where is the slag now? Did you marry the manipulative, deceitful whore? Vinny spat. Yvonne Summers had been his first and only true love. 2 years older than him she was, but even at 15, Vinny had known how to earn a bob or two and had treated that girl like a princess. Jewellery, clothes, hats, shoes. He had lavished Yvonne with expensive gifts. And how had she repaid him? By running off with a skinny little weasel of a man who was currently snivelling while resembling a trussed-up turkey. Tears of pure fright streaming down his cheeks. Trevor nodded.
Yeah, we got married and had 4 kids. Yvonne's still in Leeds, I think. I can give you the address if you want.
So what you doing back here?
We split up and I had nowhere else to go. If you want Yvonne back, you can have her, Vinny. I don't mind, honest.
Want her back? You having a laugh at my expense, Trevor?
Wrong words, mate. Wrong words, Vinny spat.
He opened the tool bag next to him and pulled out a pair of pliers.
No! Please, God, no! Trevor screamed,
wetting himself with fear as Vinny inserted the pliers into his mouth. Vinny was no qualified dentist, and as Trevor's screams echoed around the van, Michael winced and turned the volume of the radio up. By the time the Butlers reached their destination, a rural one-way lane that led to nothing but a metal gate in East Hanningfield, Vinny was splashed with blood. And after passing out, Trevor was now untied, awake again and rolling about the floor in obvious agony.
Stop crying, you fucking wuss. Man up, Vinny ordered,
giving his now toothless victim a sharp kick in the head. Michael parked up next to the Datsun Cherry they'd left there that morning. Even the full volume of the radio hadn't been able to drown out Trevor's howls.
Let's just get the job finished, Vinny. The quicker we get away from here and back to Whitechapel, the better.
Vinny took the small axe out of the tool bag.
You better go for a walk for 5 minutes, Michael. I doubt you have the stomach to watch what I'm about to do. Don't be insinuating I'm some pussy, Vinny. If I was, I wouldn't be here with you. Just do what you got to do and get your skates on.
Trevor was in too much pain to scream when Vinny dragged him out of the van by the legs. Instead, he whimpered like an injured dog and curled up in a fetal position, covering his head with his hands. He now knew how animals must feel when they were being led inside the slaughterhouse, and he just wanted death to come quickly so the pain would go away. Vinny Butler had a different plan. In some countries, it was classed as normal to chop the hands off thieves.
Be a good boy now, Trevor. Hold your right hand out for Uncle Vinny.
Sobbing his heart out, Trevor did as he was told. His mother and his winnings flashed through his mind. He was never going to get the chance to spend that now, was he? And he would never see his kids again.
Sure you want to watch this, David? Vinny joked.
Michael bore a strong resemblance to the pop star David Essex, even had the same cheeky grin. Vinny had thought it hilarious when his brother got chased down Petticoat Lane Market by a crowd of screaming tourists the previous Sunday. Michael did not want to watch what Vinny was about to do, but there was no way he was going to admit that.
Just fucking hurry up, will you? And if you ever call me David again, I'll be pulling your teeth out with pliers.
Trevor let out a blood-curdling scream as the axe tore into his wrist, then seemed to lose consciousness.
Those thieving hands of yours had to come off, didn't they, Trevor? Won't be stealing anybody's girlfriend now, will you? Nobody messes with me, and I mean nobody,
Vinny hissed, his face spattered with his victim's blood. Trying not to throw up, Michael felt a shiver travel down his spine as he heard the rustling of nearby leaves.
Did you hear that noise, Vin? I heard something coming from the bushes. Probably a hedgehog or a fox. This axe is shit. It's blunt,
Vinny complained, as he continued to hack away at Trevor's flesh. Averting his eyes from what reminded him of a scene out of a horror film, Michael heard another noise, turned around and nearly shat himself as two pairs of eyes met his.
Jesus fucking wept! I nearly had a heart attack then. There's cows watching us, Vinny.
Well, I doubt they'll be ringing the old Bill to give a statement, Vinny replied, laughing at his own wit. It ain't funny, Vin. Giving me the ebies this place is. Let's set fire to the van and get out of here.
Vinny glanced at Michael, a manic glint in his eyes.
Not until I've finished chopping the thieving cunt's hands off. He needs to be taught a lesson, taking other people's possessions. Bet he's already dead by the looks of it. He isn't going to know whether you chop his other hand off, is he? I tell you what, give me the poxy axe and I'll do the honours. You sort out the fire. And whatever you do, don't leave anything lying about.
Unlike his brother, Michael had never murdered anyone, and the bile rose in his throat as he heard a whimper come out of Trevor's mouth, then saw his eyes flicker open.
Oh, Jesus, he mumbled, dropping the axe in horror.
He then took a deep breath, reluctantly picked the axe back up and started to chop at the man's left wrist. Vinny would never let him live it down otherwise. Flesh and bone was harder to chop through than Michael had thought possible. But by the time Vinny had tidied up after them and doused the van in petrol, both hands had been severed and Trevor looked as dead as a dodo.
Put them teeth on the front seat, Michael. Then clean yourself up and get changed. Just chuck everything in the back of the van, Vinny ordered.
As strong as an ox, Vinny lifted Trevor's body into the back of the van by himself. He then chucked the hands and tools in before joining his brother in getting cleaned up. They had come well prepared. The Datsun's boot held soap, water, towels and a change of clothes.
Trevor's still alive, you know. Amazing how people die from slitting their wrists, yet can chop their hands off and they don't die immediately. Well, he won't be alive for much longer. I'm going to throw all this clobber in the back. Where's your gloves? Check all round, bruv. Make sure we haven't left anything lying about.
For the first time in his life, Vinny Butler wondered whether Michael might actually be in the same league as him. He'd always been closer to Roy, who'd been a great sibling and sound business partner, but had never really possessed that killer instinct. Until it came to putting a bullet in his own brain. Today, however, Michael had surprised and impressed Vinny immensely. Before Vinny lit the king-size match, he gave a little sermon.
Bye-bye, Trevor. I hope the slag was worth it. May your soul rot in hell, you pilfering cunt.
The explosion was clearly audible as Michael drove at top speed down the one-way lane. He glanced at his brother in the passenger seat.
What you gonna do with the teeth?
Vinny grinned.
Flick 'em out the window along the A13. One by one, of course. Be a bit like when we used to flick pebbles at people as kids.
It was 20 minutes before closing time when Vinny and Michael casually walked into the blind beggar. Both men were suited and booted and reeked of expensive aftershave as always.
Vinny, Michael, let me get you both a drink. Me and the missus were so upset to hear about your Roy and Lenny. Great lads, the pair of them, and they'll be sorely missed,
Big Stan said in a sombre tone. Vinny and Michael rarely ventured into the blind beggar. As they'd hoped, the pub was fairly busy, and already they were the centre of attention with all eyes on their grand entrance.
I'll get the drink, Stan. Ask around and see who else wants one, Vinny said. Who shall I ask?
Everybody.
Just tell them I'm buying.
When Stan toddled off to obey orders, more well-wishers came over to speak to Vinny and Michael, including the landlord.
Afters isn't a problem, lads. You just say the word if you fancy a late drink.
Actually, that's very much appreciated. Been stuck in that club all day, me and Michael have. And after everything that's happened, we're currently sick of the sight of the place. It was a good 10 minutes or so before Big Stan wandered back to inform Vinny that the round had come to £87.
It would have been cheaper, but Bobby Jackson ordered a pint for himself and his pal, plus a large chaser each,
Stan added. Seeing his brother's eyes glint dangerously as he turned to see where Jackson was, Michael grabbed hold of him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.